I'm going to talk in English, unfortunately. I do speak Italian, but I think if I speak in Italian, you're all going to wait too much and fall asleep. But the questions afterwards, feel free to ask in your own pretty language, okay? And if on the way you have any questions, anything is unclear, just feel free to interrupt me. I'm very kind, I don't bite. I'll quickly introduce myself. My name is Maria. I live and work in Zurich, in Switzerland. And I work for a company which is called Yandex, which I'm going to tell you about in a bit. And I've been in digital for more than 10 years, working on client side, on agency side, and now on search engine side. So I've kind of seen by now from all the possible angles. Now, Yandex, who here actually in the audience knows what Yandex is? Dear Lord, we're getting famous, that's good. So, Yandex is actually the main search engine of Russia. It's also present in a bunch of other countries. In Russia itself, it's actually taking almost 60% of all the search activity in the country. If we're looking at the desktop only, it's actually 80% of all the traffic coming via search. That belongs to Yandex. Yandex is a public company since 2 years. It's traded on NASDAQ U, and the capital value of Yandex now is more than $14 billion, which makes it one of the biggest tech companies worldwide. Now, if you ever been to Moscow or Russia, has anyone actually been for World Cup last year? No? No? So, if you come to Moscow ever, you will notice that you are literally surrounded by Yandex. When you live in Russia, you basically do everything through Yandex. It's very easy. You buy your tickets for the train or maybe for the concert via Yandex. You order your food, your taxi, you listen to the music, you pay for your parking when you're parking in the streets. You look for a flat to rent via real estate website. That's also Yandex. Your mail, your weather, your cloud, that's all Yandex. Apart from being the main search engine, we are also the biggest brand in the country when it comes to automated services. What does it mean? You probably wouldn't guess that Moscow is actually city number two worldwide in terms of the activity of car sharing services. So, more than 15,000 cars available, and how does it work? I don't know if in Italy the car sharing is picking up as much as it is now in US and Russia. Basically, you're in Moscow, imagine. You take your phone in your hands, you open Yandex Maps, you see the cars around you maybe 20 meters away. You walk to the car, you put your phone on the front windshield, the car opens, you sit inside. Now, because Yandex is like one login for everything, your Yandex Music and Yandex Maps accounts are automatically recognized. And that's it. You don't even need to input your favorite addresses, maybe the address of your, I don't know, school of your kids, or your favorite cafe. It's there for you already. And even the playlists which you have saved, as you have saved in Spotify, for example, they're there already for you. And you drive as wherever you need. You don't care about getting petrol in the car or about the parking fees, nothing. You just stop then where you need, you close again the car with your mobile phone and you leave. Your credit card is charged. That's about it. Now, apart from driving, and I'm going to tell you now why I'm telling you all these stories, because this is basically the future of advertising as well, believe it or not, and we'll come to that in the second part. Yandex Taxi is another big business of ours. When I say big, what I mean? You would guess that normally for a search engine, the majority of revenue, actually for most of the search engines, we're talking about 90% of the revenue coming from advertising, right? That's logical. For Yandex, it was exactly the same story up to about 2 years ago when things changed. And we're now actually getting more than 20% of our revenue of that 15 billion capitalization via this, via automated services, via taxi and drive. And I'll tell you now in a bit why it's actually important for you as for the guys who are dealing with advertising. Now, This is all fancy, but there is even a cooler story behind it. What you definitely didn't know about Russia and Yandex is that we are actually one of the top companies in the world now heavy into development of self-driving cars. Actually, the breakthrough came at the beginning of this year in January when we exhibited at CES, which is the biggest technological exhibition worldwide, in Las Vegas. And there, anyone could take a ride in self-driving cars. This is amazing. I do encourage you after the exhibition to go to YouTube and just check. There are so many videos of how normal visitors of the exhibition, just like you, they tried the car and they did the selfies inside and they put the videos on YouTube, because the experience itself is really amazing. Because you sit in the car for the first couple of minutes almost like frozen, because there is no one in the front seat, no one driving the car. And you feel kind of, you know, it's too new, it's too future, it's too space-like. But already after like 5 minutes, you're all relaxed, because actually self-driving cars, they drive very softly and very, like, it's almost being driven by your grandmother or something. It's like very, very accurate of how, you know, all the turns are made, how, you know, all the speed limits are kept and everything. So Yandex is into this. We actually believe, because we're a country of heavy traffic, especially Moscow and St. Petersburg, it's nonstop traffic. And more people actually switch from owning their own car, which economically is stupid because the car is just standing there for 5 working days in your garage because you cannot move anywhere. And if you're lucky, you can take it out at the weekend. So people actually switch to drive, to car sharing, and to taxis. And in Yandex, we believe that, well, we used to say that maybe in 10 years, actually, the public transport is going to be self-driving. But now we believe that this is coming here on our planet much faster. Why I'm saying this? Because the latest development was that we also are testing now our self-driving cars in Israel, in Tel Aviv, because the mayor of Tel Aviv is a fantastic guy who wants to make all public transport in the city self-driving by, if I'm not mistaken, 2022, which is super soon, you would agree. And last year they ran a tender, or who is going to be the company supporting this experiment, and actually Yandex won it. So now basically the taxis of Tel Aviv in the streets, normal taxis driving normal people, are becoming the Yandex self-driving cars. Now, you can check it, as I said, YouTube. We also get a lot of coverage in the main media on our self-driving technologies and the car sharing service. And Yandex Taxi has already moved out of Russia to another 15 countries, Finland and Estonia being the latest development. And what I also would like to mention here, just as an introduction of the company I'm working for, is Alice. You might not heard about her, but Alice is actually the name of our voice search assistant. Now, you would think that voice search is somewhere far away, especially for a country like Russia, but you should carefully look at the number over here, the 20%. Can you imagine that already now, this is the data for 2019, 20% of search taking place in Yandex in Russia is voice search. So people are not typing anymore, they're speaking. And if we're actually looking at the data from our apps like Yandex Maps or Yandex Navigator, which is used in the cars, there the number is 80%. So when people sit in the car, they don't type on their navigator anymore, or they don't check the maps by typing anymore, they actually talk. And this is amazing how quickly it all changed, because Alice, our voice assistant, and I'll come back to her at the very end of my presentation, she actually was launched 2 years ago, only 2 years ago, and already 1/5 of all traffic, search traffic in Russia, is taking place via voice. Now, Alice, our voice assistant, when she was launched, was actually so cool. And I will tell her a bit more about the technology behind it and why it's important for advertising. That a year ago, Google gave us an award for the technology which is standing behind Alisa. And I'll go into detail about that as well. For now, I'd like to skip to my main point over here and tell you about the new technologies in advertising and how you can make use of that. So you've all, I guess, have seen this at some point, either when you were starting marketing or maybe when you're with the colleagues in the ideal meetings discussing the digital strategy for next year and the budgets, you normally see something like that. Especially those of you who are in e-commerce, I guess you know the purchasing funnel and how usually we look at the traditional products. These are all Yandex products, but you know them very well from Google as well and other search engines like DSS, like shopping ads, display ads, video, etc., branding projects. So you look at that, and ideally that's how you would approach digital marketing, right? But the problem with all this beautiful growth that they come from textbooks. And in the reality, it's never the story. In the reality, you actually often very different departments or even very different agencies taking care of different products, and you almost never talk to each other, even though you're trying to organize e-commerce for exactly the same brand, right? So normally, then, what is the reality? When you have a brand and you enter a new market or you're launching a new product, what would you normally do? You start with a search ad. Traditionally, it's a big step, brand search. Maybe then we go into generics, another big stop. Then you go into remarketing, and that's like a huge step for the company already. And don't get me wrong, I have nothing against remarketing. Here's this data. I like this slide. It's a very cool one. It's very cool data because it tells you that remarketing actually does have a point, because yellow are conversions and red are the website visits by industry. So it basically tells you in which industries, which share of visits brings which share of conversions. And if we look at the guys, like for example, from the hotel industry, where a tiny fraction of all website visits of all sessions actually bring them for almost 40% of conversions. So for these guys and for the rest of these industries, remarketing is crucial. But how do we normally look at remarketing? We take all these touch points, like the traditional one, the website visitors, those who had the longest engagement sessions maybe. Maybe if your company is super cool and you have a few apps and you actually do proper tracking for both or for all of them, you can do cross-app promotion. Maybe you have shopping ads, which you update regularly and you mention there all the promos, etc. That would be the classical way, right? Now, that's how it would look like then, traditionally now. You launch a certain campaign, you gather a remarketing list out of it by pixel, and then you do one follow-up. Maybe it's a bit adjustment on search, maybe it's a follow-up campaign for those guys who have seen your promos already or special sales season, etc., etc. My point here that everything we did in paid search or in digital advertising before was linear, was like this. One product, one follow-up. One product, one follow-up. That's it. There was no interconnection for a number of reasons. But when you think about it now, the technologies actually allow us to go a bit different. Before, we used to advertise just a product, right? And that's what usually remains in our goals still. But we're in 2019, and we actually can start doing storytelling in advertising. We can actually give people first a story and then the product. Why is it important? I'll give you some example. I guess you all know Vans shoes, right? Or Timberland shoes. Okay, when you're buying Vans shoes, who owns a pair? Vans shoes? Good, that's more like almost a third. So when we're buying Vans shoes, guys, I think 32 if I'm not lying. I'm 32, I have two kids. Why would I buy Vans shoes? Do you think I'm their target audience? Probably not, but I am. I own like three or four pairs of Vans shoes. I'm a big fan. Why? Because when you buy Vans shoes, you don't buy a pair of just, you know, sneakers, because there are a bunch of brands which produce pretty much super similar sneakers, just like Vans. When you're buying Vans, you're actually buying an idea. they sell you an idea of being young, of being back to uni, of being cool, easygoing, and that's what you buy. So you have a choice of either pushing, you know, the product into the face of the user and say, hey, buy it, nice sneakers, minus 15% now, or you can surround the user by a little story, give them that feeling of being young, and then sell. With the Vans, I have a very specific example for you, and we'll have a look now how this is actually implemented. I saw the other day a huge billboard at the main train station of Vans shoes, and they were like new collection something, and they were pink. And the message was saying, buy pink, because not because it's girlish, but because it's cool. Okay, that's it. No call to action, nothing specific, just that. Then, a few days later, I saw a video online, probably before I started watching a movie or Game of Thrones or something like that. I saw a short video ad by Vans, which was showing me all the bunch of different people wearing these shoes. They were different age, different gender, different countries, I suspect, different ethnics, but they were all, you know, the music was cool, the mood was cool, it was youngish, it was summerish. And then, that's it, just this video. Once again, no call to action, nothing. 3 days later, I saw a normal shopping ad. It was St. Valentine's Day, so it made pretty clear that Vans actually gave a discount of, I think, 15% on that day for their new Super Pink collection. And by that time, I'm as a user, I was ready to buy them. Not because they gave me these discounts straight away, but because they told me a story via different channels a few times before I actually saw the shopping ad. So what you need to do now? First, you need to decide for your brand what the story is. What are you selling? And I don't mean the product. I mean, what is the feeling? What is the concept? What is the coolness that you're trying to sell? And then, only then, you actually think about your target audience. Who these ideal buyers are? Who are their profiles? And we're not talking about website visitors. We're not talking about very generic age categories or let's sell it to the women who are from 24 to 40, and something like that. No, you can actually be now in 2019 as detailed and as that. And that's actually very easy to implement. Now, what's cool now? In my bit longer speech about Vans, I actually mentioned seeing their billboards. How in the streets, right? So the big one which you see on the motorway or on the streets or in the bus stops. How is it relevant to our talk? I mean, because we're talking here about digital advertising. This is relevant because this is actually the reality already in Moscow and St. Petersburg. What Yandex did is that we have actually digitalized all the billboards in Moscow and St. Petersburg, the ones one you see on the big streets, the ones which you see on the bus stops, you know, on the side, the ones which you see in the underground metro passages or grocery stores, business centers as well. So not only outdoor, but indoor as well. They're digitalized. They're connected to exactly the same system, exactly the same interface where you run all your ad copies. This is, I find, amazing. Because those of you, if you ever worked in offline marketing, you would remember how we did it before. Before, if you wanted to run big billboard ads on the streets of any city, you would buy it from an agency who was holding the exclusivity for these placements for 2 weeks or maybe 1 month, and that's about it. At the end of this month, you just get a bulk number of impressions which you got, and you should be happy about it. So what we did at Yandex, we actually know that for a person driving in this car or walking in the street, to be able to physically see or percept what's written on the banner, on the billboard, he needs to stay in that red triangle for a minimum amount of seconds. Otherwise, you simply cannot read or view the video which is there. And that's what we count as real impressions. And that's what in the campaigns you actually see as the normal data. So when you're managing search campaigns, let's say, you are managing like impressions and clicks and CTR, etc., and ROI for these ad groups, etc. You do exactly the same, but except that in your ad groups, there are no keywords or no targetings, they're actually billboards. So, split by geo and by the target audience. And from the day two, here I'm going to show just some examples of how it looks like live. From the day two, basically, the advertiser can start collecting data. So they see exactly the same data they see on the normal search campaigns. They see how many impressions which they got, who are these guys who actually saw these billboards passing by either by car or by walk, just with their feet. And then they can do retargeting. But for the guys, just like Vance, just like I said, for the guys who have seen these billboards digitally, they start offline, their first touch point is offline, and then they remarket to the guys who are exactly the same person who have seen these banners, but online. And they follow up with the media, or with banner campaigns, or with shopping ads, you name it, any range of products. This is how it looks, for example, in the business centers. And even these small digital platforms are already part of the big advertising ecosystem. And this is type of data which you get already from number two, the interest, the affiliate interests of the guys who have seen the banners, their gender, their age group, their income level groups, etc. What do they do online? How they search? How can you refine them? How you can retarget them? So, what it brings us to? You remember this? You remember how everything was linear? What could it result now instead? Instead, it could result in this. So I've shown you a few examples of the outdoor banners, right? Outdoor advertising. And here is basically a client of mine. It's one of the top European electronic brands. And what did they do? They actually run simultaneously, offline, on the streets of Moscow, the digital out-of-home billboards, just like you've seen now on the photos. Then they run a short 15-second, just very catchy video ad, very atmospheric, nothing specific, just giving you a feeling. And then at the same time, they were running banners, very normal CPM media banners, with a targeting by their ideal buyer. So with the age group, with the income level group, with the short and long-term interests, etc. Now, because it's one pixel for all at Yandex, what they managed to do is that they actually collected this red one, a segment of the guys who have seen all three. So they have seen the pictures offline on the billboards, they have seen the short video, and they have seen the banners. So out of all the guys who have seen all this contact, they should be the most loyal ones, the most engaged ones in the brand by now, just like me with the pink Vans shoes, because they have seen three out of three, right? And they are the ones who are ready to buy more than anyone else, right? So what did these guys do, these advertisers? They actually, for the videos, they also created a post-view video. It's 5 seconds, but it has a call to action. So it's just a little follow-up video. They have run a bit adjustment on search. So for the guys who have seen all three products, all three media, they have made a very simple, normal bid adjustment on search. And at the same time, they created a lookalike segment on the guys who have completed the video at minimum 75%. So the guys who were actually super interested in seeing, you know, what the brand has to tell till the very end of the video. Now, super easy to implement. These are just the numbers which they are getting in terms of reach by each of these products. Don't be surprised by the numbers. Remember that Russia is super big and Moscow is officially 12 million people, citizens, and unofficially almost 20. So yeah, this means actually going super narrow in your targeting when you're looking at these numbers. Now, my message here is that basically now you have the opportunity to go very, very targeted in how you do it. You have an opportunity to combine a few channels together to do it cross-media and cross-device. So if your brand is thinking of starting a new product or entering a new market, especially a difficult market like Russia, for example, right? Don't think of the traditional ways, paid search and some remarketing, then maybe we test a bit display, videos sounds way too advanced, way too far away, because no one has video creatives. Video creatives, by the way, so that you know, can now be created out of static images. In Yandex, we have a tool which basically animates the static images, banners, which creates a short 10 to 15 seconds video for you. So even that is becoming easy. For those of you who are interested, especially now in the heavy GDPR times, how actually this is done. You probably know that each of us, we're carrying at least two or three cookies on us each, because we're in 2019 and most of us, we have a few devices, laptop, mobile phone, maybe a tab, iPad. Each device is one cookie. So basically what any search engine does for you, Yandex, Google, any, is matching these cookies together. We still don't know who you are. We still don't know your email address, phone number, or whatever else, unless you boldly save it in your Maps app. But what we know is that these two, three cookies taken together is the same person. And what it allows us to do then is to do all this fantastic targeting I was just showing. Basically, if we know that that mobile phone is you, we know that you passed that offline billboard. And if we know that that laptop is yours, we know that person watching this video, for example, of Once Again, is still you. Or if we know, for example, that iPad is yours, then we know that you are also the person who has seen the banner. So then we actually get in that, you remember the red segment, in that red pixel segment, you're the person who actually watched all three, which overall gives any search engine an opportunity to do cross-device and cross-product advertising. And if it's not the present for your brands yet, I do encourage you to walk the steps of your company, to talk to your video teams, to talk to your media teams, maybe to contact them if they are in another country, in another agency, but do connect your efforts together. Because the big brands, the biggest advertisers, they are heavy into doing this already, because this is definitely the future, or even, I would say, the present of customer engagement. So my point, all media, all channels, all levels, the same user. Approach the user gently from different sides. Don't push, you know, how we did, you know, how we used to also to push, for example, in the promo periods or in the Black Fridays. We used to push simply the products. Now it's all about surrounding. It's all about encompassing the user with the brand. What else is becoming a future? This, for example, the chats on search, they've only so far launched on Yandex as a search engine. But this is the future, which is also coming to many of us. And if your brand is having a chat support function on your website, do look into this. Because users now prefer a way shorter path for any transaction online than before. Before, we would actually looking for something, we would agree to go to the search result page, see the link which we're looking for, go to that link, scroll that website trying to find what they need. For example, if you have a question about the brand, right? Now, modern users, they prefer much shorter paths. So if they can avoid going to the website for good, they will do it. And that's what people started to do. You already get a lot of replies on the search result page itself, both in Google and in Yandex. You don't need to, you know, go to any website if you're looking for, World Cup scores or translation of the world words, etc. And this is becoming more and more. So chats on the search result page is another way how the brands are getting much closer to the user. Now, I'll skip this and I'll just finish my presentation with showing you how basically the ecosystem, the advertising ecosystem, is starting to surround the user. I'm now talking about Yandex and the opportunities which we have. for advertising in the Russian market and in other countries where we are present. But this is the future for all of us. So here's a girl, Masha. She lives in Moscow. She's 32 years old, like me. So she starts her day with social media, of course, just waking up in your bed. You start with Facebook. So she's reading messages and texts and everything. By the way, how do you think, what is the, are the top three activities of what people do on the mobile, both in Russia and in Europe? Social media, number one. What is number two and three? Weather, no. Chats, no, no. Chats are in the social media groups. No, it's top number ones, yeah. It's Facebook plus WhatsApp. Also, no, it's number seven in the ranking. Not so many gamers here, eh? Number two is gaming. And number three is? Good, video, Netflix, of course. So Masha, she keeps on reading her messages. What happens next? To get to work, she's ordering taxi or she's going by car sharing. And already there in the maps, she's getting a notification, which is basically a pop-up ad copy, which is advertising a new cafe, which just opened next to her job or in her area. Then she's driving and she's using her voice assistant, as I said before, to change songs and to change directions maybe. Now, on the way to work, she actually sees the billboards, which we were talking about, for an ad for to buy a mobile phone, maybe the latest iPhone, for example. And a few minutes later, she actually sees pretty much the same ad for the same product, but in her Yandex Navigator, the driving app. Simple. Now, then she sits down actually for a coffee, maybe in her lunch break. And she sees the same ad again, which she saw in the morning back on the billboards and back in her Maps and Navigator app. She actually sees it when scrolling through the news, because Yandex is also a news service in Russia. Then she doesn't want to actually put it off till tomorrow. She doesn't want to wait. So she goes to Yandex Market, which is a price comparison website. And she checks up the prices for this new mobile phone. And she maybe decides to buy it. Now, then she wants to book something for tonight with her friends. Once again, she does it with voice assistant because she's not into typing anymore. She books a table. She saves the V card, which is the business directory card of the cafe in her maps, so that later on when she sits in the taxi or in her own car, she doesn't need to type the address of the cafe anymore. It will be just automatically suggested to her in the evening. She orders her meal with chat assistant, which we just saw how it looks like live on the search result pages. She pays with her phone or maybe with her watch. Talking about the watch, is it popular in Italy to pay with your watch? Not yet. Then I have a quiz for you. How many do you think, where do you have many more users of Apple Pay watch, in Moscow or in New York? Moscow, since it's me talking, right? Thank you. So, she goes on, she does all her stuff. She's watching TV online, once again through Yandex, because we're the partner of a Mediateka in Russia, which basically you watch means that you watch Game of Thrones through Yandex in Russia. Yes, so she listens to music, she watches movies, she's done with her manicure, she sees an ad on the screen of the manicure salon. Once again, maybe the ad popped out because she's the target age group of that brand. Maybe it's Vichy, let's say, and she sees the ad. Then she goes home or to the restaurant. It's raining, she picks up a taxi. She once again sees some bit of information on the billboard. And she's later on ordering food, once again, through the exactly the same ecosystem through Yandex. She's watching the movies with her kids at home, once again, through the same ecosystem. We don't see yet how these touch points will become the sources of advertising again, but they will be. Because for now, we have everything split, right? We have Spotify, we have Netflix, we have Amazon, we have Apple, etc. In Russia, we already have this beauty, and in China as well, that actually it's one ecosystem dominating the whole country. And everything, we're the Spotify of Russia, we're the Netflix of Russia, we're the Uber of Russia, we're my taxi of Russia, which makes it amazingly encompassing how you can target the user and how you can surround the user with your story. I'll finish up, since I still have a couple of minutes, with voice, because since we're in 2019, at every conference we should speak about voice. I told you already that it's amazing that a fifth of what is being searched on Yandex is actually happening through voice. I find it amazing because you remember, who has seen this movie? I love that movie. Can you imagine that this happened only 6 years ago? You remember how we watched it back then? It seemed like the future. It seemed so far away. And suddenly it's already here. Suddenly, 2019, we had a fifth of search happening in voice. In 2020 or 21, we expect that it will be already 40% or even more. Already half, suddenly, of a huge search engine is done through search. Now, at Yandex, we're not monetizing voice search in any way at the moment. We actually made it open source, so anyone can create skills for the voice search, and many top brands started using it. I'll first quickly explain also where the voice search is going. Does anyone have Siri at home or Alexa? Anyone a big fan? Oh, wow, quite a lot. Good. So you would know that how normally voice search works is one-on-one condition. So basically, in the database of the voice search assistant, you have a question, and to that question, you have an answer. So it's one-on-one. So if we're talking about something stupid like the height of Everest, if she doesn't have the number in her system, she will not be able to tell you the answer, and she will say something like, sorry, could you please repeat your question, or something like that, right? Now, what Yandex did technologically, and that's why we got that award from Google, is that Alisa, our voice search assistant, she doesn't have one-on-one connection. What does it mean? It means that while we're sitting here now, she's basically scrolling. She's scrolling through every possible text ever written in Russian language online. And she's learning from that. She has the machine learning algorithm, an AI algorithm, which is helping her to do that. So what it allows her at the end to do, if me and you, we ask her the same question, she's going to give us different replies. It allows her to be humorous even. It allows you to reply to you based on what she already knows about your preferences, based on the apps you're using within the ecosystem. And this personalized search, voice search, is the future. What is also the future of brands incorporating more and more voice search into their platforms. This is a client of us, for example, Reebok, you all know it. When you do Reebok workouts, they have an app, a very cool app for that. You don't even need to touch your phone anymore. You just say, Alisa, open Reebok, my latest workout. She opens the app for you. She announces where you stopped, what you need to do next, how much time it's going to take your workout. And then once you're done with every exercise, you just tell her done. And then she tells you what to do next. Sometimes she's making jokes even here. So you tell her done. And she's like, are you sure it took way little time for you to be able to take 5 squats? So this is like how amazingly engaging and how amazingly almost funny the engagement with the user is going to be in the future. Now, pretty much that's it. My main key takeaway for you is that don't go linear, don't be boring in your advertising. Don't go the classical, traditional ways which we all know very well. Paid search, remarketing, maybe generics, maybe a bit of video, but no, it's too scary, it's too massive. Nothing is too massive anymore. The advertising is actually becoming more and more narrow scale, more narrow targeting, but also more engaging, more encompassing around the user. If you have any questions, I guess I will take them at the cafe place or down here. Feel free to reach out if you have any questions about all these technologies, about Russia, about Yandex. You're welcome.